Our first reading today is from Acts, second chapter, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from the heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now, there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon my flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. And then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved."
No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit.
Okay.
Our gospel reading today is from the Gospel of John, the 20th chapter, verses 19 through 23. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. And the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." May we hear and understand what we are learning from the Spirit of God today. Pentecost, some people call it the birthday of the church. Some people say, how could people run around with flames over their head? And how could they talk in a lot of different languages? And how could they be filled with wine? And then still be, and Peter said, no, they're not. It's only 9 a.m. What you're hearing is real. What you're seeing is real. The Holy Spirit is truly in these people. And the Holy Spirit is truly available to every one of you that's out there. But what does it mean? What is the birthday of the church? And why do we call it that? And why in the world did we have that reading from the Gospel of John that we had a few weeks ago? Same reading. From before Pentecost, right? From just after the resurrection. Well, it's simple. It's that in that particular gospel, that day was really Pentecost for the disciples. That was when he breathed the Spirit of God on them. So today, as the church celebrates Pentecost, we are as one understanding that that Spirit of God is accessible to all of us. And we're hearing that passage again about the breath of God and the breath of Jesus coming upon us. So what is it that happens at Pentecost? The men are all up in the house and it's locked. What is it that happens later in the reading from Acts that Virginia brought to us? That they're in the square and they start talking and they have this story to tell about Jesus and the work and what they should be doing and following the way. And they're all talking to all of these different people. Virginia, you did an admirable job of all of those names of places, and I was amazed. You did beautifully. But think about how many that was, and that probably wasn't even every place that was being represented. And yet, every single person that was there heard and understood the Spirit of God. They said, "How is this happening? Those are Galileans, and I know they don't speak Latin," said the Roman. "But yet, I understand them." The Egyptian, "I know they don't speak my language. But yet, they understood them." Now, I could speak Latin and a little Greek, but I could not speak, Jimmy, your language. "But yet, you're here, and you hear of the Spirit of God, and you understand me." The Spirit of God goes beyond all borders, goes beyond all divisions, goes beyond all otherness. Lately, in our country, we seem to have been pushed into looking at people suspiciously, into reacting with fear or bigotry or hate. We've been being taught this concept of otherness as something to be afraid of. And what does God's commandment say? Love God with all your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor that you've never met yet. Love your neighbor that's a different color, a different size, a different ability. There is something different about each one of us in this room. Some are younger, some are older. Some are children, some are grown, some are grandparents. Some are petite, Some are not. Yet, God says, love your neighbor. Love every one of us. I was at annual gathering on Friday. Our assistant moderator, George, was there yesterday. He texted me in the middle of it and said, I'm loving this. I don't know where he is today, but he was loving it. I loved what I saw too. We had some wonderful worship services. We had some workshops. I went to the one on immigration. It was a good gathering, and it was wonderful to see all these people that are part of the Southern California-Nevada Conference of the UCC. And I'll tell you something, we were in worship, and we were singing songs that probably, I think there were about 200 of us at the first morning worship. I would venture to say that maybe 10 people knew those songs when we started. But by the time we got through the ends of the songs, everybody was singing. For me, of course, music is a universal language. But we all kind of got it. We were all able to. I didn't know the songs. I thought they were cool, and I'll probably bring some to us here. But it showed that unity of spirit, that unity of thought. And as I was sitting there listening to the sermon, and I'll tell you about the person that gave the sermon in a moment. But as I was listening, I thought, you stole my poem for tomorrow. I told Sandy when I got home, I said, he was giving a sermon and then he read this poem that I was going to read. And I don't think that, anyway, I have the poem on a coming slide. And I'm going to read it to you anyway and talk a little bit about it in just a moment. The man giving the sermon was the general minister and president of the national level of the UCC, John Dorau. He's our head guy for the country. And I thought, well, I guess I won't be too bad, and it's okay if we're using the same poem. But, you know, that was great. And I truly enjoyed his sermon and learned much from it. I was sad that I could not go yesterday because I was busy here because he was also giving another keynote address yesterday. So I'm hoping that George will bring me news of what that is and share that with us as well. So here's the thing. What I was thinking about when I came to Pentecost and I came to what is the job of the church now? What is it? This is our birthday. What is it? What are we called to do? We're starting out. It's Pentecost. We're filled with the Spirit. We're starting on a task. We're starting on a way, on something to do, and what is it? In today's political climate, I might say it is to resist. Now, when you think of resistance, and it's going to be okay if you want to shout something out in this answer. When you think of resistance, what sort of activities do you picture in your mind? What comes to your head when you're talking about resistance? What are you going to do if you're going to go out and do something that's resistance? What is it?
Love.
Say it again.
Love.
Love. You get the gold star of the day. That is the answer. That is the exact answer. Resistance is not going out and fighting physically with somebody. Resistance is not yelling and screaming at each other. Resistance is love. That is how we can resist what troubles us. The poem. Emily Dickinson is one of my favorite poets. Probably not my all-time favorite poet, but one. This particular poem is short and very special. I had no time to hate because the grave would hinder me, and life was not so ample I could finish enmity. Nor had I time to love, but since some industry must be, this little toil of love, I thought, was large enough for me. Some industry must be. We have to do something with ourselves. We have some work to do. Some industry must be. And since there never seems time in our life to do everything, let's do love. That toil is enough for me. It isn't a typo about the capitalization of brave. That is Emily's capitalization. She says, death. That would hinder me. I don't have enough time to hate people. I'll just die instead. Life isn't long enough that I can endure that. So this little toil of love is enough for me. And how did the disciples get that love? How do we get that love into us? We accept that gift of the Holy Spirit and we use it every single day in our life. We use it every single moment. John Dorhauer told this wonderful, wonderful little story. He said he was in Palestine on one of his journeys, his mission journeys for peace and justice. He was walking down a very narrow street, and this was occupied territories, and there was a van that was driving by, and it was so close that he was walking here and the van was coming up like right there. He could have reached out and touched it. And there was a Palestinian family in the van, and there was a little six-year-old girl. And as he heard the van coming behind him, he heard this laughter, just this joyous laughter of somebody little and young having a fabulous, fabulous, wonderful time. And he turned around and he looked. He was better at telling his story, but I'll tell you anyway. He turned around and he looked, and she had a water bottle with one of those things that you pull up, like Sandy. She has a water bottle, and it has a little thing you pull up, and then you can drink. And she was squirting the water out of the window, and it was getting hit by the sun, and it was turning into rainbows and showers. And she was so delighted by this manifestation of marvelous things. And they're going along, and she's squirting the water out and laughing, and all of a sudden, she stops, and the van is coming to a stop, and she has a terrified look on her face, because there's this man in a suit and a tie walking down the street who is entirely soaked in water. Of course, it's John Dora. And he turned around, and he saw how terrified she was, and he just smiled. And then he said it. And then she took total control of the situation and the conversation. And she said, hello. And he said, hello. And she said, what's your name? And he said, I'm John. What's your name? And she told him her name. I think it was Samara. And the conversation just went on. And he said, isn't it wonderful to just be happy? And she said, yeah, it's great. He said, it's very nice to meet you. And then something changed and the van went off. And he heard them driving along and he heard the little girl laughing and laughing. Oh, and he said to her something about how she must be a very happy and smart and that she was a very beautiful little girl and that was a beautiful name. Because he then told her about how she smiled and laughed and turned around to her parents, like, did you hear that? Yeah. And it was such a delightful story. And it could have been so different. It could have been so different. But both of these people, completely different from each other, responded to each other with love. As to whether the six-year-old girl was consciously aware of the Spirit of God working in her life to make a bridge with this other person that was there, he didn't know. I don't know. And at the moment that he smiled, maybe he was just smiling because He was being attuned to what was going on. But the point of it is, we all can act as apostles, and we all can be filled with that Spirit of God, and we all can actively resist the things that are going wrong simply by our little toil of love. And to do that, we have to be full of the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to ask you to sing something with me. This is Let It Breathe On Me. Now, if you need it from your hymnal, it is in there. It's number 288. But the words are up there. But if it's easier for you to see them in your hymnal, you're welcome to do that. Would you give me a chord and we're just going to sing. Let it breathe on me, let it breathe on me, let the breath of the Spirit breathe on me, let it breathe on me, let it breathe on me. Service if you want to. You can stay in here and sit. And eventually, we go out. We go out and we work in the vineyard, whatever that vineyard is for us. It might be right here at Bethel. It might be in a school system somewhere. It might be just in our own community, in whatever our activities are. But whatever it is, we go out and we work. And we have to have God and God's Spirit next to us. And the other thing we are really, really, really called to do is to reach out across that divide of otherness and to share that Spirit of God and to take on our own little toil of life. Amen.